نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي واجعل لي وزيرا من أهلي اللهم فقهنا في الدين رب زدني علما اللهم إني أسألك علما نافعا رزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا آمين ثم آمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. سورة الحجر. The surah was also revealed in Mecca, has 6 stanzas and 99 verses, 54th by the order of revelation and 11th by the order of arrangement. The name of the surah is because of the verse number 80, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, Qazzabal ashabul hijr al mursaleen, people who refuted the people of Hijr. So that is why Allah has mentioned about the people of Hijr, and that is why it is named as Surah al-Hijr. The period of revelation of the surah is the same period as Surah Ibraheem. And the summary of the surah is that basically it is consoling Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions against all the persecution, and Allah is warning the persecutors also. And there are logical proofs for are being provided for the oneness of Allah. Verse number one, Alif Lam Ra. These are the verses of the book and a clear Quran. Perhaps those who believe will wish that they had been Muslims. Let them eat and enjoy themselves and be diverted by the false hopes, for they are going to know. And we did not destroy any city but that, for it was a known decree. No nation will precede its term, nor will they remain hereafter. And they say, oh, you upon whom the message has been sent, indeed you are mad. Astaghfirullah. Why do you not bring us the angels if you should be among the truthful? Criticism on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We do not send angels except with truth, and the disbelievers would not then be reprieved. Verse number 9, indeed it is we who sent down the Quran, and indeed we will be its guardians. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised that he will be the one to protect the Quran. How was the Quran protected? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, first of all, keeps the Ummul Kitab in the Lohe Mehfuz. It is protected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And once Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided that the Quran would be revealed to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the messengers, then it was shifted to the heavens. And the heavens, the security of the heavens was also tightened up. We will be going to the verses which will explain that. Before the prophethood of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the jinns who used to go to the heavens, they realized that we used to succeed to get some of the messages of the future previously, but now we see that it is all full up of the protecting angels. And this they had felt because the security of the heavens had been tightened when the Quran had been descended to the heavens of the earth. From here, the next protection was the leader of the angels, Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salam, accompanied with a group of guarding angels, protecting angels, he descended to bring the revelations to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And next, the revelations were entered in the memory of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Then Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to recite it to the companions, and some used to write it down, and some hafizin of Quran used to memorize the Quran. These were all mayas which were executed on the earth by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's orders to protect the Quran. And when after the life of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the period of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, we learn that there were in his caliphate a large number of about 80 of the reciters of Quran, they were martyred in the Battle of Yamama. So Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, and he got concerned and he planned the compilation of Quran, and he consulted Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala, and he refused on spot. And he said that he would not do what Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had not done in his life. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala, and who himself, he mentions that Allah got me convinced. And then they called the companion of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who used to write down the revelation, and they told him what they had desired of compilation of Quran, but he refused. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala motivated him also, and then the task was started. Quran was collected. It had been written down on stones, on leaves, on bones, on rocks, and especially on the bone of the scapula of the camels. And it was written down on leathers. And from all these things, then all the verses of Quran was collected. And then Quran was compiled. And in the period of Hazrat, this was all done in the period of, or in the caliphate of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then after compilation, it was handed over to Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And after its death, it was kept by Hazrat Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha. And then in Hazrat Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu's period of caliphate, it was punctuated. And because Quran was spread out, and the Muslim state spread out to areas of people who were non-Arabs, and for them to recite Quran with the proper pronunciation, then all these punctuations were added in the period of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So in all periods, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has raised and chosen people for the protection of his book. Allahumma ja'alna minhum, may Allah make us and our descendants one of them. And we have certainly sent messengers before you, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, among the sects of the former people, and no messenger would come to them except they ridiculed him. So this is a consolation from Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Thus do we insert denial into the heart of criminals. They will not believe in it, while there has already occurred the precedent of the former people. And even if we open to them a gate from the heaven, then they continued therein to ascend. They would say, our eyes have been dazzled. Rather, we are people affected by magic. Verse 16, and we have placed within the heaven great stars and have beautified it for the observers. And we have protected it from every devil expelled from the mercy of Allah. So these stars are what? They are a means of protection of the heavens. Except one who steals a herring and is pursued by a clear burning flame. And the earth, we have spread it and cast therein firmly set mountains and caused to grow therein something or every well-balanced thing. And we have made for you therein means of living and for those whom you are not the providers. And there is not a thing but that with us are its depositories, and we do not send it down except according to a known measure. And we have sent the fertilizing winds and sent down water from the sky and given you drinks from it, and you are not its retainer. And indeed it is we who give life and cause death, and we are the inheritor. And we have already known the preceding generations among you, and we have already known the later ones to come. And indeed your Lord will gather them. Indeed he is wise and knowing. And we did certainly create man out of clay from an altered black mud, and jinn we created before from scorching fire. And mention when your Lord said to the angels, I will create a human being out of clay from an altered black mud. And when I have proportioned him and breathed into him of my created soul, then fall down to him in prostration. So the angels prostrated, all of them entirely, except Iblis. What did he do? He refused. He refused to be with those who prostrated. And Allah said, O Iblis, what is the matter with you that you are not those with who prostrate? So remember those who disobey, and remember those who fail to prostrate and offer salah will be asked by the master. It will not go unattended. Rabbi ja'alli maqima salati wa min suriyati. He said, never would I prostrate to a human whom you created out of clay from an altered black mud. This was what? This was his arrogance. Arrogance was what? Refusing to obey the order of Allah and to look down upon the beings of Allah. Did he get away with this arrogance? How did he end up with this arrogance? Allah said, then get out of it, for indeed you are the expelled. Fakhruj minha was thrown out of the Jannah after his arrogance. And indeed upon you is the curse until the day of recompense. He said, my Lord, then reprieve me until the day they are resurrected. Remember, Shaitan also believed in Allah and understood the attributes and powers and controls of Allah. Allah said, so indeed you are of those reprieved until the day of the time well known. Iblis said, my Lord, because you have put me in error. Astaghfirullah. This was the obstinacy, arrogance, and stubbornness of Shaitan, that doing everything wrong himself, disobeying Allah himself by all his will, out of sheer arrogance, he put all the blame of disobedience on Allah. I will surely make disobedience attractive to them, and I will mislead them all, except among them, your chosen servants. Ibadullah al-Mukhlisin will be the chosen servants of Allah, who will be saved from all the tricks and plans of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bless us with ikhlas. Allah said, this is a path of return to me, that estate. Indeed, my servants, no authority will you have over them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make us your obedient servant, except those who follow you of the deviators. And indeed, hell is the promised place for them all. Hell is like what? Verse 44. It has 7 gates. For every gate is of them a portion designated. There is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as explained in this verse, there are 7 gates of hell. And remember, by the rahmah of Allah, there are 8 doors of Jannah. And the 8 doors of Jannah, one of them is the door of Salah, Babu Salah. Then there is the Babu Siyam, the door of fast. Then there is the Babu Jihad, the door of Jihad. Babu Sadqah, the door of charity. And then there is the Babu Yameen, through which only those will enter whom there will be no asking or accountability. Lucky will be those who will be asked to enter through all the 8 doors of Jannah. And they will be whom? Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, and who, when he asked Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I think you will be among those lucky ones. Similarly, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala, and who, that Abu Huraira, your desire to learn the hadith will make you one of the lucky people who will be asked to enter from all the 8 doors of the Jannah. Similarly, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned that if a person performs wuzu according to the sunnah of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and then recites ashhadu an la ilaha illallah and recites Allahumma ja'alni min at-tawwabin wa ja'alni min al-mutatahhirin, then all the 8 doors of the Jannah will open for him. Similarly, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has promised for the Muslim women that all the Muslim women who do 4 things, what? Offer 5 salah in a day, fast in the month of Ramadan, guard their private parts, and stay obedient to their husbands, will be permitted to enter Jannah through all the 8 doors of Jannah. Allahumma ja'alna minhum. Indeed, the righteous will be within the gardens and springs, having been told, enter it in peace, safe and secure, and we will remove whatever is in their breasts of resentment. So they will be brothers on thrones facing each other. No fatigue will touch them therein, nor from it will they ever be removed? Inform my servants that it is I who am forgiving and merciful. Rabbighfir warham wa anta khairur rahimin. And that it is my punishment which is painful and which is the painful punishment, and inform them about the guests of Ibraheem alayhi salam when they entered upon him and said, Salamun alaykum, we are fearful of you. The angel said, fear not, indeed we give you good tidings of a learned boy. He said, have you given me good tidings, although old age has come upon me? Then of what wonder do you inform me? They said, we have given you good tidings in truth, so do not be of the despairing. He said, and who despairs of the mercy of his Lord except those who stray? Ibraheem alayhi salam said, then what is your business here, O messengers? They said, indeed, we have been sent to a people of criminals. This was whom? The people of Hazrat Lut alayhi salam, except the family of Lut. Indeed, we will save them all, except his wife. Allah decreed that she is of those who remained behind. And when the messengers came to the family of Lut, he said, indeed, you are people of unknown. They said, but we have come to you with that about which they were disputing, and we have come to you with truth, and indeed we are truthful. So set out with your family during a portion of the night and follow behind them, and let not anyone among you look back and continue on to where you are commanded. And we have conveyed to him the decree of that matter, and that those sinners would be eliminated by early morning. And the people of the city came rejoicing. Lut said, indeed, these are my guests, so do not train me, and fear Allah, and do not grace me. They said, have we not forbidden you from protecting people? Lut said, these are my daughters. If you would be doers of lawful marriage by your life, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were in their intoxication, wandering blindly. So the shriek seized them at sunrise, and we made the highest part of the city its lowest, and rained upon them the stone of hard clay. Indeed, in that are the signs for those who discern. And indeed, those cities are situated on an established road. Indeed, in that is a sign for the believers. And the companions of the thicket were also the wrongdoers. So we took retribution for them. And indeed, both cities are on a clear highway. And certainly did the companions of Samud deny the messengers. And we gave them our signs. But from them, they were turning away, and they used to carve from mountains houses feeling secure, but the shriek seized them at early morning, so nothing availed them from what they used to earn. And we have not created the heaven and the earth and that between them except in truth. And indeed, the hour is coming. So forgive with gracious forgiveness. Indeed, your Lord, he is the knowing creator. And we have certainly given you seven of the often repeated verses and the great Quran. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and reminding him of the two greatest bounties and the valuable blessings which he blessed Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first which Allah is mentioning is sab'an min al-masani. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked what it actually means, he said that it means Surah Al-Fatiha. The Surah Fatiha means what? The seven verses, repeated verses of Quran. They are repeated in every salah, every rakat of every salah. They're repeated when we start supplicating or making dua. Surah Fatiha makes seven verses. So this makes that Bismillah is an essential part of Surah Fatiha. And its recitation will not be complete until unless we recite Bismillah before Surah Fatiha. And we also need to recite Bismillah when we recite it in our Salah. And the second blessing which Allah is mentioning here is the great Quran. The verse also highlights that the excellence of Surah Fatiha is that on one hand is Surah Fatiha, and on the other hand is the whole of Quran. This is what Surah Fatiha is, Ummul Quran. And mentioning both, in verse 88, Allah says that when I have given you the Quran and when I have given you Surah Fatiha, the Quran is what? Bahuwa khayrum mimma yajmaun. Then do what? Do not extend your eyes towards that by which we have not given enjoyment to certain categories of disbelievers, and do not grieve over them, and lower your wings to the believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that the two blessings which you have got are the best blessings. So you need not look towards or extend your eyes towards any blessing which any other person has. And say, indeed, I am a clear warner, just as we had revealed scriptures to the separators who have made the Quran into portions. Quran, making Quran into portions mean portions which they read and portions which they do not read, portions which they believe and the portions which they do not believe, portions in which they act upon and the portions which they do not act upon, the portions which they find easy to obey and the portions they find difficult to obey, and they just leave the obedience, the portions which they convey and the portions which they just conceal, who have made the Quran into portions. So by your Lord, we will surely question them all about what they used to do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked, Allah has mentioned in Surah Baqarah, أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفِرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. Do you accept a few portions of Quran and a few commandments or orders of Quran and leave the rest? أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفِرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. فَمَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا خِزْيٌ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ أَشَدِّ الْعَذَابِ. About what they used to say, then declare what you are commanded and turn away from the polytheists. Indeed, we are sufficient for you against the mockers. You may feel equal with Allah. You make equal with Allah another deity, but they are going to know. And we already know that your breast is constrained by what they say. So exalt Allah with praise of your Lord and be of those who prostrate to Him and worship your Lord until there comes to you the certainty of death. So in verse number 98 and verse 99, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving the summary that do what? Keep on, carry on doing what obedience you are, praising and exalting your Lord, prostrating to your Lord, obeying and worshiping Allah, till when? Till the certainty of death comes. That is, stay steadfast on all the obedient deeds till the time of your death. Remember, the lives of the companions of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were the actual human models of all these orders of Allah. Like Hazrat Sayyid bin Zaid, Hazrat Khubayb bin Adi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, till the last breath, their parts of the bodies being cut off, their fingers being chopped off, and blood flowing and streams of blood pouring, and still they announcing and declaring La ilaha illallah, staying steadfast on obedience, staying steadfast on their belief and faith till their last breath. Rabbana إِنَّنَا آمَنَّا فَاغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. يَا حَيُّ يَا قَيُّومُ بِرَحْمَتِكَ نَسْتَغِيثُ. يَا مُقَلِّبَ الْقُلُوبِ ثَبِّتْ قَلْبِي عَلَى دِينِكَ. يَا مُصَرِّفَ الْقُلُوبِ صَرِّفْ قَلْبِي عَلَى طَاعَتِكَ. رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَاخِذْنَا إِن نَّسِينَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا. رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَاخِذْنَا إِن نَّسِينَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا. رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا وَارْحَمْنَا. رَبِّ اغْفِرْ وَارْحَمْ وَأَنْتَ خَيْرُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. اللَّهُمَّ إِنَّكَ عَفُوٌّ كَرِيمٌ تُحِبُّ الْعَفْوَ فَاعْفُ عَنَّا فَاعْفُ عَنَّا فَاعْفُ عَنَّا. رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا وَهَبْ لَنَا مِن لَّدُنكَ الرَّحْمَةَ إِنَّكَ أَنتَ الْوَهَّابُ. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu alayk. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wasalamun alal mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ameen summa ameen. نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم نعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي واجعل لي وزيرا من اهلي اللهم فقهنا في الدين رب زدني علما Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafian, rizqan tayyiban, wa amalan mutakabbala. Amin, summa amin. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Surah Ibraheem. Surah Ibraheem is a surah which was revealed in Mecca. It has 7 stanzas and 62 verses. It is 14th by the order of arrangement and the 72nd by the order of revolution. The name of the surah is for the verse 35, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Isqala Ibraheema Rabbij al-Haza baladan amana. And this is mentioning the supplication of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam. This doesn't mean that the chapter is going to explain in detail the life of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, but is a surah in which just Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned an incidence of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam. The period of revelation is the last period of Makkah, as is shown by the verse 13, where Allah says, وَقَالَ لَزِينَ قَفَرُوا لِرُسُلِهِمْ لَنُخْرِجَنَّكُمْ مِنْ أَرْزِنَا أَوْ لَتَعُودُنَّ فِي مِلَّتِنَا. That is, where the disbelievers, they were threatened. They threatened the prophets and the messengers that they will turn them out of their localities and their communities, or they would have to return to their religion. And similarly, the people of Mecca, they had reached the climax of their oppression and their persecutions. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has narrated the events and given a deterring threat to the disbelievers or to the persecutors, saying, لَنُحْلِكَنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ, that Allah has said that we will definitely destroy all the oppressors and all the tyrants. And there Allah has also consoled the companions, promising them, saying, لَنُسْكِنَنَّهُمُ الْأَرْضَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ, that after the destruction of the tyrants, of the oppressors, of the persecutors, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will settle them in the earth after their destruction. So the basic subject and the discussion is inviting the people who are not believing towards Islam and warning all the disbelievers and giving the glad tidings to all the believers and all the companions of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Alif Lam Ra. This is a book which we have revealed to you, that you might bring mankind out of darknesses into the light by the permission of their Lord, to the path of the exalted in might, the praiseworthy. So very comprehensively, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has introduced the book, the prophet, the purpose of the revelation, and has also introduced to the right path, and has also introduced the attributes of Allah himself. This is the miracle of Quran, that in just one verse, so comprehensively, such an extensive subject has been explained in a comprehensive manner. Allah, to whom belongs whatever is in the heavens and whatever is on the earth, and woe to the disbelievers from a severe punishment. Verse number 7, the ones who prefer the worldly life over hereafter and avert people from the way of Allah, seeking to make it seem deviant, those are in extreme error. And we did not send any messenger except speaking in the language of his people to state clearly for them. And Allah sent astray thereby whom he wills and guides whom he wills. And he is exalted in might and wise. And we certainly send Musa alayhi salam with our signs, saying, bring out your people from the darknesses into the light and remind them of the days of Allah. Indeed, in that are the signs for everyone patient and grateful. And recall, O children of Israel, when Musa alayhi salam said to his people, remember the favor of Allah upon you when he saved you from the people of Pharaoh who were afflicting you with the worst of the torments and were slaughtering your newborn sons and keeping your females alive. And that was a great trial from your Lord. Verse number 7, and remember when your Lord proclaimed what? La in shakartum la azidannakum wa la in kafartum inna azabi la shadid. A proclamation from Allah. If you are grateful, I will surely increase you in favor. But if you deny, indeed my punishment is severe. A very important announcement by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says that if I mention, I reward you, I bless you, and that you are grateful, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so pleased that Allah will go on blessing his favors. But if a person is grateful, is not grateful, does not exhibit gratitude to his blessings, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do what? Will punish him with his severe punishment. Allahumma ja'alni saburan wa ja'alni shakura. And Musa alayhi salam said, if you should disbelieve, you and whoever is on the earth entirely, indeed Allah is free of need and is the praiseworthy. Has there not reached you the news of those before you, the people of Nuh alayhi salam, and Ad and Thamud, and those after them? No one knows them but Allah. Their messengers brought them clear proofs, but they returned their hands to their mouths, and they said, indeed, we disbelieve in that with which you have been sent, and indeed, we are about that to which you invite us in disquieting doubt. Their messengers said, can there be a doubt about Allah, creator of heavens and earth? He invites you that he may forgive you of your sins and he delays your death for a specific term. They said, you are not but men like us who wish to avert us from what our fathers were worshipping. So bring us a clear authority. Their messengers said to them, we are only men like you, but Allah confers favors upon whom he wills of his servants. It has never been for us to bring you evidence except by the permission of Allah, and upon Allah let the believers rely. And why should we not rely upon Allah while he has guided us to our good ways? And we will surely be patient against whatever harm you should cause us. And upon Allah, let those who would rely indeed rely. Verse number 13, and those who disbelieve said to their messengers, we will surely drive you out of our land, or you must return to our religion. So their Lord inspired to them, we will surely destroy the wrongdoers. So this is the verse which indicates the chapter was revealed before immigration of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Mecca, when there was a threat to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by his enemies, and there was a consolation for the companions. And we will surely cause you to dwell in the land. So this was a consolation for the companions and for all the believers. We will surely cause to dwell you in the land after them. That is for he who fears my position and fears my threat. Allahumma ati nafsi taqwaha. And they requested victory from Allah. and disappointed thereof was every obstinate tyrant. Before him is hell, and he will be given a drink of purulent water. Astaghfirullah Rabbi min kulli sambin wa atubu ilayh. And he will gulp it, astaghfirullah Rabbi, but will hardly be able to swallow it. Rabbana srif anna azaba jahannam, inna azabaha kana ghurama, inna hasat mustaqarrum wa maqama. And death will come to them from everywhere, but he is not to die. And before him is a massive punishment. Verse number 18, the example of those who disbelieve in their Lord is that their deeds are like ashes, which with the wind blows forcibly on a stormy day. They are unable to keep from what they earned a single thing. That is what is an extreme error. Remember, good deeds without faith and without belief, they will not be accounted. They will not be accounted at all. And similarly, belief without good deeds will be of no avail also. A combination of faith, belief, and good deeds is what is needed for entering into Jannah. As Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَأَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّةِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. So a combination of belief, faith, and also good deeds, both is needed. Have you not seen that Allah created the heavens and the earth in truth? And if He wills, He can do away with you and produce a new creation. And that is not difficult for Allah. And if they will come out for judgment before Allah all together, and the weak will say to those who were arrogant, indeed, we were your followers. So can you avail us anything against the punishment of Allah? This will be the conversation of which day? Of the day of judgment. They will say, who? The arrogant will say, if Allah had guided us, we would have guided you. It is all same for us, whether we show intolerance or our patience, there is for us no place of escape. And Shaitan will say, when the matter has been concluded, indeed Allah had promised you the promise of truth. Oh, he'll come out with the truth on the day of judgment. And he will say, what? And I promised you, but I betrayed you. I had no authority over you except that I invited you. And you were silly and foolish. You responded to me. And so do not blame me, but blame yourselves. I cannot be called to your aid, nor can you be called to my aid. Indeed, I deny your association of me with Allah before. Indeed, for the wrongdoers is a painful punishment. A'uzu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Rabbi a'uzu bika min hamazatish shayatin wa a'uzu bika rabbi an yahzuruni. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa illam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna minal khasirin. And those who believe and did righteous deeds will be admitted to gardens. So you see, you need belief plus righteous deeds. They will be admitted to gardens beneath which rivers will flow, abiding eternally therein by the permission of their Lord, and their greeting there will be peace, peace. Have you not considered how Allah presents an example, making a good word like a good tree, whose root is firmly fixed and its branches high in the sky? It produces its fruits all the time by the permission of its Lord, and Allah presents examples for the peoples that perhaps they will be reminded. So in these two verses, the verse number 24 and the verse 25, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is explaining and narrating a parable for those who believe. Allah is comparing qalibat tayyaba with what? As like shajaratin tayyibatin. The formula, la ilaha illallah. This is the kalima tayyiba. This is the first recitation when a person enters Islam or embraces Islam. So, you know, when a person enters Islam and recites La ilaha illallah, the seed of Iman enters the heart of this new convert of Islam, of this new believer. Then what happens is exactly what happens when the seed is sown in a soft, fertile land. What happens? First of all, tiny roots grow downwards and they anchor the seed firmly in the soil. And then fine, soft shoots, they come up from the top of the seed and they grow out and they emerge from the soil. And then if the farmer keeps on watering and protecting these tiny shoots, they keep on growing and they change it into a stem and branches. And then there are very soon, very soon there will be beautiful leaves and flowers and finally fruits growing on the tree. So very similar to this, when the seeds of Kalima Tayyiba, when the seeds of Iman, when the seeds of faith and belief, they enter the heart of a believer, the heart which is soft, the heart which is fertile, then tiny roots, roots of piety, love of Allah, fear of Allah and taqwa, of gratitude and shukr, of sabr or patience, of zikr or remembrance, all these tiny roots, they come out. All these spiritual worships, these are the tiny roots which come out from the seed of the formula of Iman. And they strongly settle down the Iman in the heart of the new convert of Islam or the new believer. And then what happens is, if we keep on, the believer, all of us, we keep on watering ourselves with the teachings of Quran and nourishing ourselves with the fertilizings of Hadith and Sunnah and protect the tiny shoots which are sprouting up, the shoots of Salah, of charity. If we keep on protecting them from the hot winds of hypocrisy, of transgression, then the tiny shoots will grow up into the stem of faith and belief, and they will grow into the branches of the rights of Allah and the rights of bondsmen. And then they will come out the flowers of good manners and the fruits of all forms of virtuous and righteous deeds. A full-grown tree is exactly like a mu'min, is exactly like a believer. All the stages and all the advantages. Similarly, a believer, very much like shajaratin tayyibatin, extends services to all. A full-grown tree, shajaratin tayyibatin, is useful for all the creations of Allah around the tree. So a believer, very much like the tree itself, extends services to all, maybe humans, maybe animals, maybe birds, maybe Muslims, maybe non-Muslims. So similarly, a Muslim, a believer, like a tree, cleans, purifies, and refreshes the environment. A Muslim, a mu'min, like a tree, removes all the dust, the dirt, the pollution in his environment. A mu'min, like a tree, makes the climate comfortable, suitable, and very, very enjoyable and very pleasant. A mu'min, like a tree, adds beauty, adds coolness to the environment, and is a source of coolness of the eyes for his parents, of his family. A mu'min, like a tree, provides shade, shelter to all those around him. A mu'min, like the tree, the stem of a tree gives support, gives a point of rest for all those around him. A believer, a mu'min, very much like a tree, extends help, support, care, shelter, protection to the humans, to the animals, to the birds, everyone. A Muslim, a mu'min, a believer, very much like a tree, does what? With his presence, spreads the scent of the teachings of Quran and Hadith and like a tree, even after the death, the messages and the teachings and the examples of the Mu'min are useful even after his death. And remember, a Muslim, a believer, very much like a shajaratin, tayyibatin, before its life ends, plans and arranges for small plants, which will be its replacement after its death. Remember, when there are no fruit, when there is no fruit on a tree, the branches, they rise towards the sky. But when the plant and when the branches, they get laden with the fruit, the branches bow down towards the earth. Similarly, as long as a believer has no fruits of virtuous deeds, of pious deeds, there might be arrogance in his temperament. But when the believer becomes pious, becomes righteous, becomes God-fearing, and adopts virtuous deeds, then he becomes humbled. He bows down, he humbles down in front of Allah and all those bondsmen of Allah also. Allahumma ja'alni saburan wa ja'alni shakura. Ya muqallib al-qalubi sabbit qalbi ala dinik. Ya musarrif al-qurubi sarrif qalbi ala tu'atik. Rabbana innana amanna faghfir lana zunubana waqina azab an-nar waqina azab al-qabri waqina azab al-hashri waqina azab al-mizan. Have you not seen that Allah created the heavens and the earth in truth? If he wills, he can do away with you and produce a new creation, and that is not difficult for Allah. And they will come out for judgment before Allah altogether. And the weak will say to those who were arrogant indeed, we were your followers. So can you avail us anything against the punishment of Allah? We've gone through these verses. I think we are repeating. Let's go ahead. Yes. So here we come to verse number 27. Allah keeps firm those who believe with the firm word in the worldly life and hereafter, and Allah sends astray the wrongdoers, and Allah does what he wills. Have you not considered those who exchange the favor of Allah for disbelief and settle their people in the home of ruin? It is hell which they will enter to burn, and wretched is the settlement. And they have attributed to Allah equals to mislead people from his way. Say, enjoy yourselves, for indeed your destination is fire. Allahumma ajirna min an-nar. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, tell my servants who have believed to establish prayer and to spend from what we have provided them secretly and publicly before a day comes in which there will be no exchange nor any friendship. It is Allah who created the heavens and the earth and sent down the rain from the sky and produced thereby some fruits as provisions for you and subjected for you the ships to sail through the ship to the sea by his command and subjected for you the rivers. And he subjected for you the sun and the moon, continuous in orbit, and subjected for you the night and the day. Verse 34, and he gave you from all you asked for him. And if you should count the favors of Allah, you could not enumerate them. Indeed, mankind is generally most unjust and ungrateful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa in tu'uddu ni'matullahi la tuhsuha. For the second time in this chapter is Allah talking about gratitude. Allah explains that I have blessed you with whatever you have asked and much more than that. Much, much more than that. But still, there are people who are ungrateful. Talking about gratitude. Gratitude is what? It is remembering, it is mentioning, it is acknowledging the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is gratitude? It is a combined form of a comprehensive form of a worship. And it is really liked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, his blessings on all of us are so numerous. They are just innumerable. They are countless. They are endless. Allah has blessed us much more than our needs. He has blessed us what we know and what we don't know. He has blessed us what we are aware of and what we are not even aware of. He has blessed us what are in our knowledge and what are not even in our knowledge. He has blessed us with what we have asked for and what we have not even asked for. And remember, greater are the blessings of Allah which we have not asked for, and greater are the blessings of Allah which we don't even know of. That is why he orders us to be grateful. As in Surah Baqarah, verse 152, Allah orders, Faskuruni askurkum washkuruli wala takfiruni. Remember me, I shall remember you. And remember Allah how? Washkuruli. When you remember me, be grateful to me and do not deny my blessings. So remember, gratitude is what? It is a do of Quran. Being grateful is a do of Quran. And what is the don't of Quran? Don't be ungrateful to Allah. So how can we be grateful to Allah? How can any person be grateful to the blessings of Allah? How do we, like comparing in our worldly lives, if somebody gives us a gift, how do we thank the person? We thank by the word of mouth, then we feel obliged in our hearts, and then we try to mention or talk about it, and then we try to repay or return the gift. So to be grateful to Allah, what do we need to do? We should say Alhamdulillah verbally by word of mouth. And then we should feel obliged. We should feel indebted to Allah, taking him as our benefactor. And then we should consider him. We should considering him as our benefactor, feeling indebted to him, we should try to obey him even more. We should try to obey him even more to seek his pleasure. And then another way of being grateful to Allah is to use the blessings of Allah according to his orders, according to his limits, according to his commandments. So this way, gratitude is going to be a comprehensive worship with physical, with monetary, with spiritual components. And why do we need to be grateful? What are the advantages of being grateful? The first advantage which we went through the verse today is that Allah proclaimed, "Wa istazana rabbukum la in shakartum la azidannakum wa la in kafartum inna azabi la shadid." That when sustainer who created you, when he blesses you, you are grateful to him, he will be so happy with your gratitude that he will give you even more. But if you are not grateful, if you are ungrateful, then he will punish you with a severe punishment. So that is why we need to be grateful for all the blessings and bounties of Allah, so that we are even more blessed. So together, even greater blessings of Allah and bounties of Allah, we need to be grateful, and we will gather even greater bounties. And to save ourselves from the severe punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to be grateful. So this is actually what happens, that when a person is ungrateful, there is a punishment from Allah. Like we learn from the behavior of Hazrat Dawood alayhi salam and Hazrat Sulaiman alayhi salam. Hazrat Sulaiman alayhi salam, when he received when he saw the throne of the queen of Saba in front of him brought in by one of his slaves, what did he say? He said in Surah Naml, verse number 40, he said, "Hadha min fadli rabbi li yabluwani a ashkuru am akfur wa man shakara fa inna ma shakara li nafsi wa man kafara fa inna rabbi ghaniyun kareem." He said that this all is because of the blessings of my Allah. And he has given this all to me because he wanted to check me. He wanted to check me that I am grateful or I am ungrateful. And anybody who is grateful will avail of it for himself. And if anybody is ungrateful, he will receive the punishment for it himself. So this is a fact. And it happens so. Remember that when a person is grateful, then his sanity operates. And he stays sane. And then only he will be able to see, to count, and to feel his blessings. But on the contrary, if he turns ungrateful, he gets insane. And getting insane, he will not be able to see or to count or to realize or to remember the bounties of Allah. That is why gratitude is a bliss. It is one of the best riches and the best bounties and the choicest blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person, even if he has thousands of blessings of Allah, but he does not have a grateful soul, then despite having all the blessings of Allah, he will always be cribbing and grumbling and bickering. He will be upset. He will be tense. He will not be happy. But on the contrary, a person who is a deprived one, but he has a grateful heart, he has a grateful soul, then he will be in all the situations, in all the hardships, in all the crises, deprived. He will be still happy, contented, satisfied, relaxed. So this is the blessing of Allah. And this is the reward of gratitude. And this is the punishment of being ungrateful to Allah. And remember, a person who can't be grateful to Allah just won't be able to be grateful to his fellow beings also. So the first, we need to be grateful to Allah. And then the next, we need to be grateful to our parents. As Allah says in Quran, "Anishkuru li wa li walidayk wa ilayya al-masir." Be grateful to me and to your parents. Why? Remember, to me you shall return. Because you know we need to be grateful to our parents. The right of parents come immediately after Allah. And moreover, all what we have, all what we are, wherever we've reached, whatever we've achieved is a blessing of Allah, but it's because of the work, of the hardships, of the efforts, of the struggle of our parents. So we need to be grateful to our parents after the gratitude of Allah. And for a woman, after Allah, she needs to be grateful to her husband. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam explained, there is a tradition in Bukhari that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that today I was shown a horrible sight, a horrible scene of the hellfire. And there I saw majority of women. Companions asked, what was the reason? What was the reason? For what deed was there a majority of women in that horrible scene of the hellfire? Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, because of the two behaviors, they are complaining and they are ungrateful. And the companions asked, are they ungrateful to Allah? Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, no, they are ungrateful to their husbands. They are ungrateful to their husbands. And in the words of the tradition of Muslim, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam explained that how are they ungrateful to their husbands? That throughout their life, they keep on receiving all forms of care and love and protection and provisions and all forms of things from their husbands and throughout their life. But the moment there is one issue, there is one problem created by the husband, she says, I have never, never, ever have I received anything from you. Like by one thing, she turns everything down. So complaining. So this is being ungrateful to the husband also. like the words of the supplication by a prophet. He said, Rabbi awzi'ni an ashkura ni'mataka allati an'amta alayya wa ala walidayya wa an a'mala salihan tarzahu wa adkhilni bi rahmatika fi 'ibadika as-salihin. So he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bless me the ability that I be grateful to what you have blessed me, and I be grateful to what you blessed my parents also. And out of gratitude, I want the ability to do virtuous deeds which might please you. So this exactly is what gratitude and what is the extent of gratitude we need to do. But we need to see around us how many of people are ungrateful, and what lack of gratitude is surrounding all of us. How this lack of shukr and gratitude is prevailing in the society these days. For example, you see, there is a person having all the blessings. The only thing which the person doesn't have is a personal house, continuously cribbing and grumbling, I don't have my personal house, longing for a personal house. When the person gets a house, starts complaining, the plot is too small. If the plot is large enough, the next complaint, the locality of the place is not good. If the locality is good, the next complaint, the fittings and the furnishings of the house is not latest, it's not up to the mark. If the house is big enough, in a posh locality, well furnished with the best and the latest fittings and everything, then the next complaint. The furniture, all of our, the furniture of our house is all old-fashioned. It is old-fashioned and obsolete. Then, even if the furniture is the latest and it is modern and it is all new, the next complaint. We don't have any servants to look after the house. Not happy in any state of affairs. Lady having to go to a party, all complains. I don't have clothes. I don't have a dress. If I have a dress, I don't have a new dress. If I have a new dress, the dress is not designer. If it is a designer, don't have matching handbags or shoes. If I have matching handbags or shoes, they are not latest and designers. If I have everything, then I don't have a designer jewelry. Cribbing, cribbing, cribbing. This is lack of gratitude. This is being ungrateful, never content, never happy. A girl married, living in a separate independent system. You hear her saying, if you had to run a separate house, you would have known. Not happy, not contented. The second one, living in a combined supported system, ungrateful, coming up. If only you had to stay and stand your in-laws all the day long, you would know. Neither of them happy, neither of them content in any of the situation, both ungrateful. Children at the dining table, why do we get bread today? Why not rice? If they get rice, why not pasta? If get pasta, why not pizza? If get pizza, why homemade pizza? Endless, thankless, commence mom's cribbing today. But we need to learn. From where did the children learn? Where did the children catch? Obviously from the thankless mom herself, who was continuously in the habit of cribbing and grumbling continuously to her husband instead of being grateful to the husband. From there did the children learn. And now the mom is cribbing for the children's being ungrateful. Gratitude, remember, has no relation with the blessings. It is just a frame of mind. It is just a state of outlook to life. In the same condition, there will be a person will be very grateful, and there will be another person will be totally ungrateful. As it is said, two men behind the prison bars, one looked at the darkness and the other saw the stars. So let's ask for the ability of gratitude. Allahumma ja'alni saburan wa ja'alni shakura. Rabbi a'ini ala zikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. Verse number 43. and mention of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when Hazrat Ibraheem alayhi salam said. So now here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about the faith and belief and gratitude gives example of Hazrat Ibraheem alayhi salam, how he was blessed with the blessings of sons in his old age, and then receiving the blessings of sons, how did he show his gratitude towards Allah? Mention when Ibraheem alayhi salam said, "My Lord, make this city of Makkah secure and keep me and my sons away from worshipping of the idols." This was the gratitude of Hazrat Ibraheem alayhi salam. When he was blessed with sons in his old age, how did he show his gratitude? By being sensitive about any form of polytheism or finding partners with Allah, and by sticking to the oneness of Allah. "My Lord, indeed they who all the idols they have led astray many among the people, so whoever follows me, then he is of me, and whoever disobeys me, indeed you are yet forgiving and merciful." Verse number 20:37, "Our Lord, I have settled some of my descendants in an uncultivated valley near your sacred house, our Lord, that they may establish prayer. So make hearts among the people inclined towards them and provide for them from fruits that they might be grateful. O Lord, indeed you know what we conceal and what we declare, and nothing is hidden from Allah on the earth or in the heaven. Praise to Allah who has granted to me in old age Ismail and Ishaq. Indeed, my Lord is the hearer of supplication. My Lord, make me an establisher of prayer. Rabbi ja'alni maqim as-salati wa min zurriyati. Rabbana taqabbal du'a. Rabbana ighfirli wa li walidayya wa lil mu'minina yawma yaqumul hisab." The grateful Hazrat Ibraheem alayhi salam's supplication was, "My Lord, make me establisher of prayer, and many from my descendants, our Lord, and accept my supplication. Our Lord, forgive me and my parents and believers on the day the account is established." So this was the gratitude of Hazrat Ibraheem alayhi salam by his action. What was the gratitude? That he sacrificed all the worldly desires and settled his son, Hazrat Ismail alayhi salam, close to Baytullah, where Wadi Ghair Zizira, where there was no agriculture, where there was no fields, nothing to eat, no provisions, not a drop of blood, not a soul of person, no animals, no birds, no provision whatsoever. He settled such a sacrifice of Hazrat Hajra and of Hazrat Ismail, settling them in the Wadi Ghair Zizira without any source of provisions, close to the place where the house of Allah was to be constructed, so that they would establish Salah. Gratitude for blessing him with Ismail and Ishaq in his old age was not like that with the parents of today. What do the parents of today do when they are blessed with children? Planning and struggling to make them successful in this world only, to direct all efforts towards making them rise and achieve in this worldly life. But to thank Allah for the blessings of his sons at an old age, he tried, he sacrificed, he struggled, and then prayed for them to establish Salah, to be humbled, to be obedient servants of Allah. And then his supplications in this verse 40 and 41, what do we learn? Another very, very vital point. Hazrat Ibraheem alayhi salam, Khalilullah, the friend of Allah, he made this supplication, Rabbi ja'alni maqima salati wa min zurriyati, Allah, make me and make my descendants the establishers of Salah. And we know that the supplications of prophets and messengers were heard and accepted and granted. But he was not content with just making of dua. In addition, He sacrificed and he made them settle close to Kaaba. He got them migrated and he got them settled close to Kaaba. All the way from Palestine, he shifted and he settled them all by themselves in the Wadi Ghayr Zira, where the house was to be constructed so that they would establish Salah. What an immense sacrifice for protection of Salah of the descendant. What is the state of affairs today? Mothers, come up to me, ask me to suggest regarding a supplication to make their children start offering Salah. Some recitation which they will offer so that their sons will start establishing Salah. We believe, we desire that just making dua will make change. There's no doubt. Dua does wonders. Dua actually does wonders. But Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam did not only make dua, but he made sacrifice for this purpose also. What is the state of sacrifice today? Just imagine a child sleeping late, busy studying for his exams. Next morning, the mother doesn't wake him up. The mother just does not wake him out for Fajr out of pity. Oh, poor fellow, staying awake the whole night, just slept an hour back. If I wake him up for Fajr, he won't be able to take a few hours of sleep and will not be fresh for the exams. Which exams? The temporary exams, really? The exam? The big exam? Yawm-e-Din? What about that? This exam is so important that we can't sacrifice our sleep, forgetting that the Salah will be the first question on the day of judgment. The day of the judgment whose results will have eternal rewards or punishments. So if we are not even prepared to sacrifice our sleep, to sacrifice our sleep, we are not prepared to sacrifice the tuition classes, then just making dua, رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مَقِيمَ السَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ سُرِّيَتِي. And never think that Allah is aware of what the wrongdoers do. He only delays them for a day when eyes will stare in horror, racing ahead, their heads raised up. Their glance does not come back to them and their hearts are void. And O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned the people of a day when the punishment will come to them. And those who did wrong will say, O Lord, delay for us a short term. We will answer your call and follow the messengers. But it will be said, had you not sworn before that for you there will be no cessation, and you lived among the dwellings of those who wronged themselves, and it had become clear to you how we dealt with them, and we presented for you many examples, and they had planned their plan, but with Allah is recorded their plan, even if their plans had been sufficient to do away with the mountains. So never think that Allah would fail in his promises to his messengers. Indeed, Allah is exalted in might and order of retribution. It will be on the day of the earth will be replaced by another earth, and the heavens as well, and all the creatures will come out before Allah and the one, the prevailing, and you will see the criminals that day bound together in shackles, their garments of liquid pitch, and their faces covered by fire. Allahumma ajirna minan nar. So that Allah will recompense every soul for what it earned. Indeed, Allah is swift in account. This Quran is notification for people that they may be warned thereby, and that they may know that He is but one Allah, and that those of understanding will be reminded. رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مَقِيمَ السَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ سُرِيَتِي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help all of us, our descendants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make us all the establishers of prayer. Make salah coolness of our eyes. Help us enjoy our salah. Help us reach a feeling of conversing with the Lord in our salah. Accept the salah we offer and forgive our deficits and forgetfulness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help us adopt the sunnah of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our salah. Rabbi ja'alni maqima salati wa min zurriyati. Allahumma hasibna hisaban yaseera. Ameen, summa ameen.